Hi everyone and welcome to the first video of the new year. In this one, I will take a closer look at this Dell Latitude 5590. During the video, I'll do a small introduction and review of this machine, we will take a look at the internals and upgrade the memory, and finally, we'll see how this device performs by doing some benchmarks. The Dell Latitude 5590 got released somewhere around mid-2018 and came with a 7th or 8th generation Intel Core CPU. The one I have right here is equipped with a Core i5-8250U, came with 8GB of DDR4 pre-installed and a 256GB SATA SSD. We'll see more about that in detail later. The Dell Latitude series is a line of laptops targeted at businesses, and the 5000 series stands for decent and serious workstation models. This 5590, part of those series, definitely fits in there. With its 15.6-inch screen, you can't really call it ultra portable, but as you can see, it isn't too bulky or heavy either. It's about 37.5 cm by 25 and is a good 2 cm thick while weighing around 1.9 kg. As you can see, the power adapter is also very reasonable in size, and mine even came with a 90 watt model, while a 65 watt power supply should be sufficient as well for this laptop. In terms of connectivity, we can see the following, starting with the right side. We have a noble wedge lock slot, classic VGA connector, a USB 3 Type-B port, place for an optional SIM card slot, and a headset connector. On the left side, we have USB-C with DisplayPort support, another USB-B port, SD card reader, and a smart card reader. On the back, we can find an RJ45 for gigabit networking, HDMI, a third USB-B port and a power connector. The front doesn't have any connectors, but has the 2 speakers built in and a status LED. After we open up the laptop, we get to see the screen and keyboard. The resolution of the screen is Full HD, and that was not upgradable at the time. Despite this not longer being considered as very high anymore these days, the quality of the image is really good and everything looks pretty sharp and crispy. Brightness goes high enough as well, and the viewing angles are what you would expect. For controlling the mouse pointer, you can use the regular trackpad with physical buttons beneath it. These buttons have a nice click and the trackpad feels accurate and responsive too. It's not as good as what you would see on a MacBook, but definitely better quality than a lot of other laptops out there. You could also use the pointing stick here between the keyboard. Dell calls this a track point, and there is an extra set of buttons closer towards the stick. It does what it has to do, but I never really was a fan of these kind of things. The keyboard then. It's pretty nice to type on and has a pleasant feedback to it. It might not look very fancy, but while using the laptop, you can feel right away that this is not a budget model, and you can use the keyboard to type longer documents without any problem or frustration. Due to the size, this device also comes with a built-in numeric keypad, which is always convenient, of course. Let's have a look at the internals of the laptop now. Opening it up is pretty easy. You just need to remove the 8 screws that hold the bottom cover. Fortunately, there are no hidden screws under any stickers or under the rubber feet, which you can sometimes see, and is pretty annoying. After getting all the screws out, you can use a plastic spudger over here, or even a kitchen knife, to release the bottom cover. Once it pops out a bit, you can gently remove it to reveal the internals of this machine. The largest space here is taken by that 68 watt-hour 4-cell battery which is in the laptop. We have space for a standard 2.5-inch SATA drive as well, which requires an optional proprietary SATA cable. Instead, we have an M.2 SATA SSD in here. We can also see the CMOS battery, Wi-Fi card, optional LTE modem slot, the CPU cooler, display connector, and the 2 DDR4 SODIMM slots for memory, for which currently one of them is populated with an 8GB model. As I mentioned in the beginning, we will upgrade this to 16GB, and we will simply do that by adding this additional 8GB module in the second free slot. According to Dell, the laptop supports up to 32 GB. There we go, simple as that, that's really all it takes. Let's close up the machine again now by putting back the bottom cover. Push it back in place. And then get it fixed by putting back those 8 screws that hold the cover firmly in place. Now let's turn on the machine and press F12 to get to the boot menu. Here, let's start by going to the BIOS setup and see what it has to say about the system. So, in system information, we can see already that additional 8 GB module which we just installed, resulting in the desired total of 16 GB of memory. The CPU is listed here as well, and as I already mentioned, the model we have for this machine is an 8th generation Core i5-8250U. Here we can also see that M.2 drive that got installed. Unfortunately, this is a SATA drive, but the machine does support NVMe as well, which would give you a nice boost in this performance if you decide to upgrade to that. Other than that, the BIOS has plenty of options to configure, and that's always nice to see, as it gives you the possibility to set things how you like them. Let's get out of here and let the laptop boot into Windows 11 now. And while the device originally came with Windows 10, it is fully compatible with Windows 11 and you don't need to do any workarounds. Now that we're here, let's start by having a look at About Your PC. In here, we can see once more the same information. The i5-8250U CPU and 16 GB of memory. Task Manager confirms this to us once more, and here we can also see some more details about the CPU, for example that it has 4 cores and 8 threads. Other than that, the CPU has 6 MB of cache and has a base frequency of 1.6 GHz, but can boost even up to 3.4 GHz. You might have noticed the U in the CPU's name, which indicates that this is a low power laptop CPU. In practice, this means that the CPU only has a TDP of 15 W, which explains the lower base frequency and why we only need a 65 W power supply for this machine. Now, back to Task Manager. For the memory, there is not much news here as well. We have 2 DDR4 SODIMM modules, resulting in 16 GB in total, but we knew that already. We can also see our M.2 SATA SSD, dual band AC wireless adapter, and integrated graphics. Enough about the details, let's see how all of this translates into performance numbers. And as I typically do, let me start by running the CPU benchmark in Geekbench 5. There we go, 3170 as a multi-core score. If we compare this with some other machines that I tested, we can see that this CPU performs more or less like a 6th generation i5 or a 4th generation i7. And that's mainly because of the low power consumption we have here, so that U variant of the CPU. Let me repeat the same test with Geekbench 6 now. ...3166 this time for multicore, and again that's more or less the same relatively to the other machines I tested earlier. Now let's see how that M.2 SATA drive performs. Roughly 450 MB per second write speed and 500 MB per second read speed. That's not bad at all for a SATA drive and actually a proper match with that CPU performance we got here. As mentioned before, you could drastically improve this performance by replacing that SATA M.2 drive with an NVMe variant, as that is definitely supported on this machine. As we could see, we also have an 802.11 AC Wi-Fi adapter, and let's see how that one performs. We are connected to an access point that supports this standard, and have a decent signal strength. So let me now simply copy over a large file and see what performance we can get. It looks like we're getting around 280 megabytes per second or 32 to 33 megabytes per second. Not bad at all. The laptop also features a built-in microphone and webcam, but neither of these are really standing out in terms of quality. Especially in bad lighting, it doesn't really perform well, but that's usually the case with these built-in webcams. That was all I got for this video. All in all, this is a nice and decent laptop. Performance is not top-notch, but as a reward, you do get a proper battery life and portability. The build quality is excellent, and that translates in a proper keyboard, trackpad, and display, making this laptop a pleasure to work with for a longer time. Thanks a lot for watching this. Let me know if you have some questions or comments. Give me a like if you have enjoyed this, and do consider to subscribe if you're interested in more of the same. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.